Well, a lot of families have been affected by the COVID-19 crisis. Many people have found themselves working at home. They're at home with children. They can't go to school. And I have a brother outside of Philadelphia who's in that boat. And they've been trying to find time to spend quality time together, enjoying life and making the best of a difficult situation. And because my brother knows I'm a big bird watcher, and I just produced a video for you folks on bird feeders, he was asking me about bird feeders, and he and his young children are putting up bird feeders in their yard. And he asked me, what are the most important things I need to think about when placing a bird feeder? And I said, well, two things. You need to feed them the right food, and more importantly, you need to protect them. The placement of the feeders is critical. You need to put it near a tree or a bush so the bird has cover and does not have to worry about being ambushed by a hawk or some other bird that would try to attack them. Birds only get about 50% of their food from bird feeders, so they'll usually find a way to eat outside of the feeders, and you don't have to worry about them being dependent. But when we turn to today's gospel about Jesus the Good Shepherd and we read the 23rd Psalm, we can see that the two primary jobs of the shepherd are to feed his sheep and to protect them. Because sheep, unlike wild birds and animals, are 100% dependent on the shepherd for food and protection. As we read through scriptures, Old and New Testament, an age-old theology that I want to look at today is the twofold knowledge of God. The twofold knowledge of God is the theology that understanding faith is like a coin with two sides. And on one side, we have knowledge of God and God's character. And on the other side, we have knowledge of who we are as people. And to have a full understanding of faith, we need twofold knowledge of knowing God and knowing who we are. And today's sermon will be focusing on understanding God, but also understanding our own character and our needs. Starting with Psalm 23, if we read it in Hebrew, it's called Mitzmor David, which means the Song of David. And if we think of who David was in the Old Testament, he spent his younger years as a boy shepherding sheep. And then later, as he advanced and became a more important person, he was given great responsibility by God. Namely, the story that every child probably has heard in Sunday school is the story of David and Goliath. And we think of the great danger that he faced as he went to do battle with Goliath, the giant Philistine. And then later in his life, after he was chosen by God to succeed King Saul as the king of Israel, David spent time running away from King Saul, who wanted to kill him because he was a threat to him. So who better to write a song about a shepherd than a boy who was a shepherd and also understood the dangers of the wild and the danger of politics and human evil? One of the unique things about Psalm 23 is that it's written in the first person. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. And this gives us the first important clue about understanding Psalm 23. This is a very personal scripture about a personal understanding and a personal relationship with God. The other thing that we need to remember is that for many, many centuries, Psalm 23 has been read in the Jewish Bible by the Jewish community. And when the Jewish community reads Psalm 23, they can see that there are many images in the psalm that related to the entire history of Israel. When we start off hearing about I shall not want or I shall not lack, it recalls images of how Israel wandered in the wilderness and lacked food and lacked water, yet God provided. We hear a recurring theme of God's restoring of the souls that's found throughout the Psalms. And when we hear The psalmist David writes, "He leads me in paths of righteousness." Those same words harken back to the song of Moses and Miriam that they sang after they crossed the Red Sea. Many of the other important themes that we find in the Old Testament with the patriarchs of Abraham and Isaac is that they encounter difficult times of famine, Abraham in Egypt and later Isaac. And at those times, God sent them a message: "Do not be afraid, I am with you." And we also see the theme of Jewish table ritual of worship, of Shabbat, Shabbos, in here, as God talks about preparing a table. So what I'd like to do first is to go down verse by verse and explain in depth how we can look at this from a Jewish perspective, and I'll even be talking about the Hebrew. We have to remember that Hebrew, as a Near Eastern language, is a very imagery-oriented and poetic language, and that a lot of this scripture is a huge metaphor using God as a shepherd. It begins by saying, "The Lord is my shepherd." So many of Israel's great leaders were shepherds. Moses was a shepherd. And the Old Testament kings and leaders were often referred to as shepherds of the flock. "I lack nothing, I shall not want." And nobody knew more than the people of Israel what it was like to be refugees and to lack in a difficult time. "He has made me lie down in grassy pastures." I want to expand on that a little bit. Sometimes when my son and I go out scouting for deer in hunting season, we find grassy areas in the forest and farmland that have been pressed down by the deer as they lay in the grass. And actually, the word in Hebrew, "robatz," which means to lie down, is emphasizing that this is a place where the sheep or the person can lie down and recline and relax and enjoy the stillness of a beautiful setting. "He leads me by quiet water." And water in the Bible and the Old and New Testament has many images. We have floods and torrents. We also have droughts. And this image of quiet waters shows a peaceful and calming and restorative environment. And he says in verse 3, "He restores my inner soul." This is coming from the English translation of the Jewish Bible. And when we look at the word "restore," which is shuv in Hebrew, it means to bring back. It means to call back something that's been missing or damaged. And I think that's a very important theme for us all right now, because many of us have been robbed of peace and struggle with anxiety, and we need restoration of our spirits and soul. "He guides me in paths of righteousness," and right paths. And here we see a very important word that any of our listeners who are Jewish or know Hebrew, the word tzedek. Tzedek in Hebrew, it means what is right. And when we talk about what is right, it's back to that twofold knowledge: what is right for God and what is right for us. And when we are in God's will and we follow him as the shepherd, and the right path for God is the right path for us, that is how God can guide us, feed us, protect us, and bless us. And then in the usual King James Version, we hear, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." If we look at the original Hebrew, it actually says "death shadow." And again, this is that imagery I was talking about. To a Hebrew reader, they would see these ravines that are found throughout Israel in the Israeli topography, where people would walk through the ravine or the valley, and predators, wolves, enemies could be up above them at a strategic high point to ambush them and hurt them. So even though we walk through these paths where odds are against us, and it seems like there's so many threats that could pounce upon us, whether it's illness or a mean person in our life, It says, we will fear no evil, and the Jewish English translation is, we will fear no disaster. Why? And this harkens back to what God said to the patriarchs. You are with me. God is with me. Your rod and your staff, they reassure me. The rod was actually more like a club that could be used as an offensive weapon to defend and protect against an intruder, a predator, or a poacher. The staff, a walking stick, sometimes shown as a crook, shepherd's crook, represents stability and a steady foot through a difficult time. You prepare a table for me. As I said, the two great responsibilities of the shepherd are to not just protect, but to feed the sheep. And this imagery of the table is so vital throughout the scriptures. You've seen the famous painting of the Last Supper and how Jesus enjoyed fellowship with his followers. And to those in the Jewish community who celebrate Shabbat or have a meal at home on a Friday night, there's a very well-known prayer that they say called the Chamotzi. I'd like to recite that. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Hamotzi Lachem Min Haaretz, which means, blessed are you, Lord God, King of all creation, who brings forth bread from the earth. And incidentally, for our Catholic residents that are listening, this is one of the Eucharistic prayers during the Eucharistic liturgy that has been incorporated. And when we hear this image of the table, and we think of that prayer and bread, we think of how Israel was lacking in the wilderness and God provided manna, some type of supernatural bread, which actually in Hebrew, manna means what is it? Because they didn't know what it was. And he provided. But at this table, David is realistic. It isn't some type of fantasy of the perfect world. He says, you prepare us a table in the presence of my enemies. That the truth in life is in the church and our families and our communities. Sometimes there are people who are around us who always don't have our best interest at heart. You anointed my head with oil and my cup runneth over. My cup is overflowing. Anointing in the Bible represents a blessing. And the cup overflowing and running over is a symbol of abundance, that God will never run out of his grace and love to bless us. And then finally, it says at the end, and this is the Jewish English translation, goodness and grace will pursue me. In King James, it says it will follow me all the days of my life. But the actual Hebrew that is used in the original scripture is radaf, which means pursue. God pursues us even when we feel like we can't go any further. And what does he pursue us with? Goodness and grace. And these are two more words I want to break down. The word for goodness in this, actually the Hebrew, is ektova chod, chesed. Sorry, atova chesed, and tov is for our Jewish residents, and maybe other people, you've heard the term mazel tov. This is the same tov, it means goodness. Goodness and grace. Now, what do we mean by grace? He said, actually, David wrote chesed. Chesed means loving kindness. And at this point, I want to focus back on this picture that I have today of Jesus the Good Shepherd loving and embracing a young lamb. And one of the most important things that we need to remember is that behind God's faithfulness and all the things he does for us is this tender love, just like Jesus shows in that picture with holding that lamb. He's not only caring for the lamb, he loves the lamb. And the scripture ends by saying that this will follow, God will pursue us with this goodness and grace all the days of our life forever. Well, I want to break down some of the theological claims and point in this. What do we learn about God in this scripture? And I'll relate it to the gospel reading. Well, the first thing we learn about God today is that We can trust that God is a good and faithful shepherd. God is good, God is reliable, and He has our best interests at heart. He is our personal God. And we heard that echoed in the John text when he talks about knowing the sheep by their name and they know his voice. Only in a personal relationship can people recognize a voice with each other. And the second thing is that God's provision is perfect. He knows exactly what we need and can perfectly meet those needs. Now, that doesn't always mean we get what we want. Many times in life, God gives us what we need, not what we want. But if we trust that what we're getting from God is perfect, then we can accept it and realize that maybe the problem, as I mentioned in my prayer of confession, is that our own sinfulness and skewed thinking is not recognizing a blessing that God's giving us, sometimes packaged as a challenge. And then next, God's provision not only feeds up us, but it renews us. It satisfies us in a way so that it can transform us and that we may grow spiritually. So it is reasonable, based off the scriptures, and this is our authority of the truth as believers, whether you're Jewish or Christian, the written word of God is the authority that we may trust. It is reasonable to trust that God, like that shepherd, wants us to trust Him, knowing that He is trustworthy. I've always said it's important that people have a childlike faith, and at the end of the service today, I've got a lovely choir selection from the Scottish Youth Choir, The Lord of Sky and Sea, and look at the faces on those young children and youth that are singing that song and think of the faith of a child. The other thing that we realize in these scriptures, and this is important now because I'm sure most of you watching now are thinking, where are we going with this pandemic? Every day things are changing, there's more restrictions, I don't know how to plan things in the future, and we need guidance. And this scripture shows us that God, the shepherd, He guides us in the right path, the right way. One of the things I get to do as a pastor is have people call me and say, I need to make a decision, but I'm not sure what the right choice is. And I'll ask them what they're thinking about, what they're deciding. And then I will say to them, before I give them my counsel, have you prayed about that? And you'd be surprised how many people haven't taken the time. They've thought a lot about it, but they haven't prayed about it. And this is so important because the only way that we can find the right path, especially in challenging times, is to seek counsel through prayer and God and godly people that God puts in our lives. And we can trust that God guides us to the right decision because He always has our best interest in mind. And then the shepherd not only feeds, he protects. And we do need protection, don't we? My wife works in healthcare as a nurse at the med center, and one of the things that we do when I drive her to work during this COVID crisis is we always pray for God's protection. God will protect us, and He wants us to ask Him for that protection. It's not just the superstitious thing. Sometimes when we pray for protection, what it does is it prepares our heart and our spirit so that we may have better judgment to make tricky decisions in dangerous times, especially when we struggle with anxiety. And then finally, we can see that we can rejoice. We can find comfort. We can find hope because we know that God's grace is what sustains us. We know that God will spare no blessing. And we know that because God wants to be in constant communion with us, that the limits of those blessings are more restricted on how much we connect and how much we are willing to receive than it is of God being limited. God is not limited. Going back to the picture of Jesus and the lamb and this Hebrew word chesed, loving kindness. That's the foundation of our faith as Christians and believers. Being in constant relationship with God is so important. your time in prayer. And I know many of you have a lot of free time on your hands, and you're feeling bored. And I thought about my brother that I talked about at the beginning of the sermon, and he said to me, he said, this time has been a blessing. I'm spending that quality time with my children. We're getting to know each other on a deeper level. They're getting to feel how much I love them. Well, God wants to do that with you during this time too. He does it through your prayer and devotion time, and he also does it through our coworkers that feed you and come to you. They are the arms, the hands of God that he's using to feed you and protect you. They're the mini shepherds that the great shepherd is using to take care of you, his flock, during this difficult time. So as I end my sermon, I just want to remind everyone to remember how good God is, and more importantly, how much God loves you. He knows you by name. He knows every hair on your head, and he wants to provide for you. He wants to protect you. Embrace that and rejoice in knowing that nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate us from that love, the love of God in Jesus Christ. Amen.